Oh, g'day there, and welcome back to the BYC for 2021. Like the Black Caps, we're starting the year off with a number one ranking. Unlike the Black Caps, we're struggling for depth, and a collapse is always imminent. Settle in as we take a microscope, or at very least a magnifying glass, to the Test Series against Pakistan, and grab yourself a coldie as we look ahead to the decider between Australia and India at the Gabatoir. Beside me, I have, as always, the most hated man in Australia, Dylan Cleaver, and from his beachside lair in Whangamatara is Paul Ford, co-founder of the Beige Brigade and godfather of the original Gangster BYC podcast. Paul, yes, was that Jason? You and Tracy dancing on the roof of Blackie's Bar and Cafe on New Year's Eve?
Oh, wow, that's a big call. I mean, they do have good mochaccinos, so I wouldn't put it past myself to try and break in if they're not open after hours. What do you do when you need a mochaccino, Jason? But no, I wasn't there on New Year's Eve.
I've kind of lost a little bit of respect for you, the fact that you actually even drink a mochaccino. Just have a proper coffee, for God's sake. Mochaccino. What a wanker. Hey, before we start, do us a favour. Make sure you hit the subscribe and the auto-download button. Also, give us a 5-star rating if you think we've earned it, and you know we have. And let us know what shadow batting shot you're practising at the moment. But let's crack into it, fellas. Dylan, how are you, by the way? Looking very tanned.
Yeah, I'm very good. I'm coming in hot in the new year, actually.
Yeah, you're looking hot, mate.
Is he sunburnt?
Yeah, it's just
a little bit.
It's either that or he's having liver failure. I'm not sure. Now, number one test ranking for the Black Caps. After a perfect test record this summer, a brilliant 2-0 series win over Pakistan. Williamson and the runs, fellas.
Yeah, look, I mean, what more can you say about steady the ship? But I'm going to try. 639 runs over the summer at 159. But the remarkable thing about it, he was dismissed 4 times, right? 3 of them were on the slog chasing quick runs. So the guy's not only a legend, he's also very selfless. I don't want to skite or anything, but I was at all those tests and he was just remarkable.
Yeah. Well, he's just got such amazing concentration and he's so disciplined about what he does. And he has is there anyone in world cricket that has a better technique than Kane Williamson? Because I can't think of anyone, because he plays that ball right underneath his nose, doesn't he?
I used to think that Joe Root had a very classical kind of English technique, but he's been struggling for runs a little lately. I also really enjoy watching Kohli bat in terms of technical excellence, but Williamson trumps him, I think, for just defensive technique. Ability that all his edges fall short of slips, which is a skill in itself, really.
Absolutely. Paul, he is our little master, really, isn't he?
Yeah, he is. And I mean, yeah, he's so unassuming and humble. And of course, that obviously drives opposition teams, I think, a little bit batty, because there's just no outward signs of anything getting under his skin. He rarely makes mistakes. And I mean, that's one thing to do it for a few hours. But when you're going to come out across 3 tests and bat for 29 hours, you must get quite sick of it. And to do it with no sleep, given his wife has given birth to a new baby. He's been on paternity leave, he's been changing nappies, not watching cricket videos, but still getting down for a couple of hours of nets every day. He's just extraordinary, really. Andy Bull said it beautifully, I thought. He said in The Guardian, quiet and unassuming competence, a resourcefulness born of immense technical expertise. And I thought that summed it up pretty neatly.
Absolutely. And you bring up the point, I mean, even when he celebrates his century or his double century, it's very calm, it's very contained. And very disciplined. You juxtapose that against, say, a Davey Dum Dum Warner celebration and or a Steve Smith celebration, or dare I say it, that man, Manus Labuschagne, that kind of thing. You know, Everything about Shane Williamson just screams control.
Yeah, look, he didn't even take his helmet off for his double ton in Christchurch, and he didn't even acknowledge the crowd at all when they rose to clap him for 7,000 runs. Like, it was just pointless to him. It didn't mean anything on the day, so why celebrate it?
If it's not part of his routine, he's not going to do it, right? He's just going to stay in his lane and do his thing.
Great stuff. And very Kiwi, too. Very Kiwi. Hey, Jamieson, we've written here developing nicely, but what have we stumbled upon here, boys? He has a real X factor. The one thing I'll always say about New Zealand sides is we're fighters. We're nuggety. You know that you have to be at your best to beat New Zealand, but sometimes we've lacked the X factor, and Jamieson brings that X factor in spades, in my view.
Yeah, and look, 27 wickets at under 13 runs per wicket is extraordinary. Handy batsman. We've had this discussion. I'm not ready to call him a genuine all-rounder yet, but he could be. He's that. He's certainly got technical skills with the bat. But what I really loved about watching him this summer was just that sense of anticipation, like a buzz around the crowd. Every time he came on, you were kind of waiting for something to happen, and invariably, obviously, with those stats, it did happen.
Yeah, you didn't wait very long, that's for sure. There was a lovely moment where, at the end of that, was it the penultimate day at Christchurch, where Trent Bolt, you could see, he said to Williamson, "Mate, it's not me. You need Jamieson on," and flicking the ball, and he got that wicket late in the day. I mean, that was obviously an incredible moment in terms of teamwork and selflessness and all those things. But also, to your point, you know, Jamieson got the burden, you know, got it handed over to him, shouldered it and got the wicket. You know, amazing. So very aggressive. And then he's got that bounce, of course, which they bang on about day in, day out. But most importantly, he's moving the ball both ways now, and you know, makes it very, very difficult.
I tell you what, I'm really excited at the prospect of Jamieson playing in Australia. I mean, I'm thinking of those bouncy wickets over there. He is going to be a huge asset. Interesting point about Jamieson too, you know, because a lot of people talk about his bounce, and it is prolific. It's extraordinary because of his height, obviously. But of all the New Zealand bowlers, he actually pitches the ball up more than the other New Zealand bowlers. I think he was more full than the other New Zealand bowlers. And when you've got batsmen hovering on the back foot because they're expecting that ball up around the nipple area, the Adam's apple area, that's a real advantage to him.
Yeah, and look, I don't want to keep banging on about the height and bounce, but he can get fuller because of those physical advantages he's got. Whereas, you know, a Southie who tends to slide the ball along the wicket a little more looking for that outswing, Trent, doing the same, but obviously left arm looking for the inswing. They go a bit full. They get driven through mid-off through the covers. Jamieson gets a little bit full, and it only bounces up to sort of box height.
Yeah, yeah.
And you're right, Jace. He would be very handy in Australia, but our next test matches are going to, most likely, looks like it's going to be England in June. The killer is going to be a very, very effective unit on those English pitches too.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, he's a really exciting prospect. You know, And I believe Tim Southee's bowling as good as he's ever bowled. He's in great form. Maybe, you know, lovely Trenty is struggling a little bit, but he's sort of in the zone. And that's what I mean about that X factor, is that those guys are good, steady bowlers. Wagner, of course, we can always rely on him to get 150%, but I think Jamieson brings that real X factor to our side, which is incredibly exciting.
Yeah, you mentioned Trent Bolt is a good, steady bowler. Well, he's actually better than that, and he has been for a number of years. In some ways, he was our X factor guy, but you're right, he's just a little bit searching, I think, at the moment is probably the right word for it. He's not out of form by any stretch.
No.
But
pushing too hard, maybe, a little.
Correct.
Let's talk about Harry Nipps, because of all the of all the players that were potentially under threat in this season, it was him. When you look at Conway, when you look at guys like Young, he's come in and smashed a crap load of runs. But let's also factor into that he's been dropped about 150 times.
Yeah, it's one of those summers where statistically you're going to look back on this and think, jeepers, Henry Nicholls played out of his skin, didn't he? And in many ways he did, but he didn't cover himself in glory in Hamilton in the first test against the West Indies, and he was genuinely, I think, under pressure for that second test. He got, about six chances in that test. He turned it into his highest test score. Then he goes to Christchurch, dismissed early off a no ball, turns it into a, dropped it another couple of times, turns it into a 150. But are we being a little bit harsh on him here by mentioning the luck all
look,
the time?
I think it's a tremendous achievement. And the reality is he made the most of those opportunities. And that's all you can do in Test cricket. Because as we all know in this game, another day, you know, you get out to an absolute screamer and there's nothing you can do about it. Full credit to him. But he did ride his luck. And guys like Taylor and all the other players at Timor, you've got to be kidding me. This is getting out of hand.
Yeah, well, what, as you say, dropped five times out off a no ball too, I think, I remember. And a number of edges. You know, I don't know about that adage about you make your own luck. It was just, he just, I guess, soldiered on. And let's not forget, of course, he played with, was it a thigh injury or a sore leg at least? And,
yeah, he did, you know, a hammy. Or a calf, sorry.
And if Neil Wagner had been playing with a bunch of broken toes, we probably would have lauded Nicholls for being so tough. But it kind of didn't look that tough compared to Waggers.
Yeah, well, let's talk about Waggers. I mean, bowling with broken toes, did we expect anything less?
11 overs straight.
I mean, no, I think that, you know, if he broke a leg, he'd still come pounding in.
Well, didn't he only break one, and then he went home and broke the second one himself just to make himself feel tougher? Is that what happened?
Quite possibly.
Yeah, apparently the tough guy image was, lessened a little or diluted slightly by news coming out of the dressing room that he screamed like an absolute baby whenever that needle got near his toes.
Yeah, it's going to end up being one of those stories. I mean, sure, it's not a Buck Shelford ripped scrotum, is it? But it's certainly up there in terms of playing through an injury for New Zealand. And I think he ended up with 13 wickets at 22 over the summer. Another extraordinary season for him.
This is the thing, with Wagner, because you look at the guy and you go, well, he's a pretty, what does he bowl, late 120s, early 130s? Mm. He's not express pace, but he just keeps going like the Energizer Bunny. And, he was, let's be honest about it, our best player in Australia in that last series.
Yeah, and he's got that amazing ability to bowl constantly between the kind of the nipple and the clavicle regions.
So that horrible zone for any batsman.
Yeah, and so the umpires can't give it the, you've had your one bounce of this over, your two bounces this over, so he can just keep doing it relentlessly. And for tail-end batsmen, particularly from the subcontinent where you can live on the front foot,
yes,
playing that sort of stuff is just niggly.
Yeah, it is. Because it was actually, when you look back on that first test, it was quite a tight finish at the Mount.
Oh, it was really tight. And in fact, New Zealand did what Australia could not do this week, which was, ignore a flat wicket and a really stubborn resistance and just push through it and kind of will themselves to victory. And Wagner was a big part of that.
That's why we're the number one team in the world, Dylan Cleaver.
Absolutely.